Hello everyone and welcome to another Final Fantasy 14 guide. I'm sure you're interested in trying out tanking and don't know for sure where to look for some help, right? Well, you've come to the right place. Before we get started, however, I want you to stop thinking of tanking as some out of this world important role. You're basically just a tankier melee DPS with a few extra mitigation buttons on top. Nothing to worry about, really. Tanking really isn't as intimidating as it looks like. Now, let's get into the video with some tips to give you an intro to tanking and some advanced tips later in the video for the extra curious people. The first beginner tip is always check if your tank stance is on at the start of the dungeons. When you sink down for a dungeon, for example when you run a Reverend Inglet and your level goes down, your stance also gets turned off, even if you already had it on prior to entering the dungeon, so keep your eyes peeled for that. Keep your armor up to date and try your best to always have the best armor available for your level, whether it's vendor gear, dungeon gear or Thompson gear. You can check if you got any better gear by pressing the recommended gear button here, but be careful since at lower levels there is DPS gear that can be worn by tanks too. The recommended gear system will sometimes suggest this DPS gear even though it's not actually that good for tanks. It won't affect you too much, but you'll take more damage caused by the lack in defense in this said DPS gear. Make sure you always have mob aggro in dungeons. There's two terms that people might use when referring to aggro, such as hate or enmity, and these just refer to you having the attention of enemies. If you got aggro on mobs, they don't hit the helpful healer in the back tank to keep you alive, or the DPS that are tanked to kill them as fast as possible. The easiest way to get aggro on trash packs in dungeons is to use their AoE or area of effect skills, such as total eclipse for paladin, overpower for warrior, etc. Note that later you get the second skill to combo after the first one, but I'm only referring to the first one in the chain for now in order to not confuse people that are still leveling. For single target, you just do your normal single target rotation and you should be good to go. We'll talk a bit more in depth about aggro later on. Make sure you always face enemies away from your party. A lot of enemies have attacks that hit or cleave in front of them, so you'll be expected to face them away from the group. They also have those target rings under them, which is how melees get their positionals. If a mob or a boss spins like a record, then the melees will be very angry with you, so make sure you don't spin the mobs around too much unless a mechanic calls for you to move around. Make sure you always avoid dodgeable AoEs. You've probably seen various orange telegraph markers on the ground in your adventure. Those are enemy attack telegraphs and you want to move out of those in order to avoid taking unnecessary damage. Then try sending back to where you were before. As soon as an AoE indicator disappears, you're usually safe to walk back in that spot without actually getting hurt. This might go a bit against what we talked about at tip number 4 and might seem a bit hectic at first, but once you get used to it, you'll be graciously weaving in and out of AoE attacks like a ballerina, a very strong clad in plate ballerina. My last beginner tips for new tanks is using your defensive claws efficiently. These are actions that you have and they reduce the damage that you take from the mobs. At first, as you get used to running dungeons, try your best to rotate through these as much as possible in order to maximize the damage reduction. Make sure you don't stack too many of these early on, but later down the line in higher level dungeons, you might need to stack 1, 2 or more defensives depending on how hard the mobs in the pools you do hit. You'll have to gauge that by yourself after gaining some experience, but after you understand how much damage you take or how many defensive cooldowns you need to survive, you'll be good to go. Don't be afraid to use your invulnerability in order to help with staying alive. Just make sure that you use it in a way that it doesn't panic your healer, such as using Super Bullet on Gunbreaker after you just got healed to full. It sometimes happens due to miscommunication, but don't worry about it as we've all used at least one Super Bullet or two after the Benediction. Sorry, White Mages. That's it for beginner tips. If you think that you're good to go, you can turn off the video right here and then come back when you want more information. Coming up next will be some intermediate tips. Going back to aggro, on the left side of your screen you can see the enemy tier list which comes up whenever you're in combat. To the left side of the enemy's names, you'll see one of three symbols. Green for no aggro, yellow or orange for close to getting aggro, and a full red circle which means that you have aggro or the mobs are targeting you. Unless a mob has a unique way of choosing a target, such as being tethered to a player specifically for example, and they'll ignore a tank, you'll want your aggro list to always be filled with red circles next to the enemy's names. If you're playing with a mouse and keyboard, then you can even manually target mobs out of the enemy tier list, which is very helpful if that one pesky mob just doesn't want to aggro onto you, and you want to use a ranged attack to pull the aggro back onto you. In order to get aggro on a pack of monsters, you can do one of two things. You can either use a ranged attack on one of the monsters, and then when they clump up, you use AoE skills to get aggro on all of them, or you walk into the pack and directly AoE them all. The second method is a bit riskier, since mobs will not always be clumped up immediately, meaning you might have to run after a mob or two, which aggro on someone else, especially if the healer put a heal over time spell on you. But it's comfier if you're trying to pull more than one pack at once, since you don't have to spam only ranged attacks on every single monster you meet on the way. You might be wondering about using provoke for pulling or how to use it in general. It works if a mob is already in combat, but if the mob is not yet pulled or already hitting you, it will be way weaker. It has a few more advanced uses though, and we'll be talking about those on a different topic of this guide. Keep in mind that you can use it on stragglers that move away from the pack when you're clumping them together, or if you want to pull mobs from a bigger distance. Using provoke on a monster that is not in combat will only gauge aggro on it, but it will not give you the full aggro bar like it does with monsters already in combat. Don't spam it on cooldown though. Let's cover some more things about defensive cooldowns. First, don't forget about your roll actions, they're all helpful in some way or another. Some of them are amazing for mitigating damage during big pulls or helping party members. Reprisal is an AoE mitigation tool that puts a debuff on all mobs around you and it reduces their damage by 10%. But it can also be used on mobs or bosses that use attacks which hit the whole party in order to reduce the damage that the entire group takes. Arm's Length is a roll action that a lot of tanks forget about, even veterans. Normally, you'd use it for knockback prevention, but there is a second effect to it, which is that during the duration of Arm's Length, all mobs that hit you get a debuff that slows their attack speed. It might not seem big on paper, but the less autos you take, the more damage you mitigate. Keep in mind that even though it doesn't work on endgame bosses, it does work on monster packs in dungeons and even some early game dungeon bosses. Low blow stuns your opponent for 5 seconds, which is good if you want to stop an enemy from dealing damage, or you can use it as a pseudo cast interruption. Same as Arm's Length, it doesn't work on endgame bosses, but it does work on regular monster packs and early game bosses. On that note, Interjection is a tank ability that can be used to interrupt skills. If you see an enemy cast bar blinking while a cast is happening, that means you can interrupt it. It is an ability that will be used to clear many mechanics throughout your adventures and helps tremendously during dungeons for stopping some attacks that might hurt you badly or do damage to the entire party. Learn what attacks can be interrupted and always be on the lookout for new interruptible abilities in order to stop them. One last thing for defensive cooldowns. While big dungeon pulls and rotation of the cooldowns is important, bosses instead have attacks that are designed to kill or heavily damage tanks, known as tankbusters. Learning which abilities are a tankbuster is a per boss thing, which means that some bosses have instant attacks that deal more damage, so you need to learn the timing. Some have a cast bar attached to them, and some just have a big wind-up animation which won't tell you much until you get smacked in the face with enough force to dwarf even a big bang. I won't talk too much about this since, as I said, it's very specific on a boss-to-boss basis, but on bosses, use defensive cooldowns to reduce damage from their auto-attacks as well. Don't use them just for a dungeon trash. Feel free to rotate cooldowns here and there on normal trials and dungeon bosses until you get a feel for what is a tankbuster and what's not. As for the last of the intermediate tips, always do big pulls. It's very common to pull entire thirds of dungeon mobs in one single pull, but be careful. If you're new to tanking, tell your group if you're uncomfortable with big pulls, or alternatively, if you want to try out big pulls. This will get your entire party on the same page, especially the healers, who may or may not be comfortable with it themselves. To ease into it, start by pulling 2 to 3 packs of enemies at once, then go up from there. Keep in mind that at low level, not a lot of jobs actually have AoEs, so you might want to consider doing at most 2 packs at once. Other than that, you just incorporate all of the advice that was said in this video up to this point. Look for enemies you can stun or interrupt, remember to rotate your cooldown so that you don't take as much damage and dodge abilities aimed at you. It's basically what you've been practicing in your adventure, amplified by a number of monsters. If your gear is out of date however, don't try all of this on the whim, because it will definitely make the experience worse for both you and your party. Oh yeah, another tip I can give you regarding grounding up monsters is that some monsters cast abilities from a distance, making them a pain to clump up with the others, yes? Well, when this happens, just look for nearby walls or protrusions in the wall that will break line of sight. This will force them to run after you, which means they'll join the rest of the monsters in the pack. Be careful, however, that you don't break line of sight from your healer at the same time, since you might end up tanking the floor instead of the monsters, and your entire group will pay the price for that. Now, for advanced tips. This section will seem fairly standard to veteran tanks, but will contain extremely important advice if you plan on taking a tank into highly difficulty endgame content. Sadly, all the tips I'll mention here vary from boss to boss, just as every other bit of content I've given. There's so many things that you can learn from the tanking role that come either from experience or watching already experienced tanks and how they play certain fights. Take what you've learned up to this point and walk into this section expecting to be more curious coming out of it. I'm sure there's veteran tanks that might watch this video and want to bring up specific fights or specific scenarios that are a little more common for them. And don't be afraid to talk about it in the comments, because I'd love to read about your experience as tanking. Alright, back to aggro. I know that all of these jumps will most likely give you a whiplash, but bear with me. In many endgame fights, almost all of them actually, you'll be having a co-tank in your party, since all endgame happens in a party of 2 tanks, 2 healers and 4 DPS. Sometimes there are additional monsters or adds that the second tank needs to pick up, which makes having 2 tanks logical. Other times, instead, the boss puts a debuff on the tank which forces you to swap who is actually tanking the boss, also known as a tank swap. In order to do a tank swap, the tank who is not currently being hit, also known as the off tank or OT for short, uses provoke on the boss, and the tank that is currently getting hit by the boss, also known as the main tank or MT for short, uses shirk while targeting the OT. Shirk is a roll action that allows the tank to transfer some of their enmity, or 25% to be exact, to the person they are targeting, so it's perfect for making sure that the tank using it will not take back the aggro from the tank that used provoke. You can even use a shirk macro, which always targets the tank. Make sure, however, that the party list is arranged properly, and the number that you use in the macro written on the screen is the same as the other tank's position in the party list. For example, if your co-tank is a 50 in the party, you will want to put the number 5 between the arrows. This will help you immensely because you will not have to target them manually to use the ability, which removes the awkwardness of having to target someone else in the middle of an intense fight or phase. Keep in mind, however, that macros sometimes work very weirdly and your shirk might not go through, so make sure it goes on cooldown. There are also encounters where the boss summons big ad monsters and tether together if they're kept together, buffing them in one way or another. Sometimes the boss itself is made out of 2 mobs that need to be moved further or closer depending on the situation. In most 24-man raids and some 8-man fights, if you see 2 or more big mobs appearing, you're free to assume that they need to split up until told otherwise. It's not always the case, but it's worth doing it if you're sure of the situation. Don't forget about your utility in fights. Some tanks have some sort of party shields or raid-wide damage mitigation, whether that would be the reprise that we've mentioned earlier, or using abilities such as Dark Missionary or Shake It Off. These are essential to endgame content, especially early Savage progression, when you might not be extremely geared, so every bit of mitigation matters. It's a good habit to get used to mitigating raid-wide damage even in easier content, just to build up muscle memory. On deadly bosses, the cooldown rotation won't work, so you'll need to change up the tactics, because otherwise you'll get killed by a tank busters. You might want to work out if you need more than one mitigation ability to stay alive. Keep in mind that the mitigation values in Final Fantasy are multiplicative, not additive. I will put up some images on the screen which show how much you mitigate by stacking abilities on every tank on the screen, but please take this information with a grain of salt, because the information is current as of Shadowbringers expansion, but it might change in the future. What you can do if you don't have any cooldowns, or you just want to save some, and the big attack is coming, is you just use your invulnerability. These are abilities that prevent you from dying for the duration of the ability, except Dark Knight's Living Dead, where if you don't get healed to full HP after you take the damage and fall to 1 HP, you die, and can be used from bosses with back-to-back tankbusters or big dungeon pulls if you want to give the healer a bit of room to breathe. Raids are more structured, so as you gain fight knowledge, you'll be able to map out your use of defensive cooldowns, and invulnerability uses will be planned instead of use the panic buttons. My last tip for this guide would be paying attention to how you move your enemies and bosses when you have to move them. Sometimes you learn to position bosses in such a way that it benefits you and your party, or you to ensure that your team can continue hitting them in order to kill them faster. Sometimes it's mandatory to have a boss in a particular position in order to solve certain mechanics, and other times the boss is throwing a hissy fit and it just can't be moved, so you have to deal with it by considering on how you can stay in range of the boss while also solving mechanics successfully. I cannot stress this enough, but if you are scared because you may have not understood everything completely, it's fine. Rewind and listen to those parts again, or drop the video for now, go out into the world with what you have learned, and then come back later when you get a bit more experience under the belt and you feel like you can understand the information then. The advanced part of the video requires some specific fight-to-fight knowledge, so it's something that you pick up as you go. The most important thing about the advanced section is being willing to learn. You won't become a high-end raider in one day, just as Rome wasn't built in one either. You won't get really far into the endgame content either if you don't have the mentality that you want to learn. If that's the case, maybe consider other roles that you might find more appealing. This wraps up the tanking guide. There are so many small details that I could still be talking about, but it would drag the video for too long and they're extremely specific to every situation, so I'm gonna say, if you got any questions, don't be afraid to ask in the comments down below, I'll try my best to answer them all. Or, if you're a veteran that just wants to give some advice, go down there as well and either write what advice you think would be good for people to know, or just answer some of those questions, because I'm sure people would have a lot. Ultimately, don't be nervous about going tanking, it's really not as tough as you might think it is. Anyway, if you made it this far into the video, thank you for watching, maybe throw in a like or a subscription if you want to see more like this. I'll be making more guides coming up to Endwalker, and the next guide will be about healing, so I'll see you then. Take care!